In this video, I'll be discussing how to predict the solubility of ionic compounds based on the ion's charge and size that make up the ionic compounds. You may have seen a solubility table either in a book or another resource that you've used for Chem 1A. The purpose of this video is to explain the reasoning behind the solubility table. Our objective is to predict ionic compound solubility based on the ions that make up the compound, namely the charges of those ions and their size. You'll have seen in a previous video in the solutions module that solutions could be strong, weak, or non-electrolytes. A strong electrolyte is a solution containing an ionic compound that dissolves in water. This solution conducts electricity because ions can move freely within the system. A weak electrolyte, however, contains a slightly soluble ionic compound with only a small fraction of ions in the solution. This means that these solutions do not conduct electricity as well. A non-electrolyte is a solution with an ionic compound potentially that doesn't dissolve at all, meaning that electric charge can't travel and the solution doesn't conduct electricity at all. Let's look at the molecular level reasoning behind why some solutions are strong, some are weak, and some are non-electrolytes. What's going on at the molecular level in the case of a soluble compound, such as lithium nitrate, is that the attraction between the ions that make up that ionic lattice are stronger with water than they are with themselves. This causes a compound to be soluble because when it's added to water, the attraction holding the ions in the lattice together can be overcome. Let's look at calcium sulfide as an example of an insoluble compound. The opposite is true here, meaning that the attraction between ions in the lattice is stronger than it is with water. This means that this attraction cannot be overcome, and the compound therefore is insoluble in water. Let's look at two different sets of examples here to try to get at the reasoning behind this behavior. Here are compounds A and B, which are generic ionic compounds. Both compound A and compound B contain a cation with a positive 1 charge and an anion with a negative 1 charge. The difference, however, is that the cation in compound B is much larger than in compound A. This means the distance between the ions in the lattice in compound B is much greater than A. Based on this and your chemical intuition, which compound would you expect to be more attract? Would you expect the ions in that compound to be more attracted to each other, A or B? I would predict that compound A, the ions would be more attracted to each other because they're closer together. Let's look at two other compounds, C and D. Now you'll notice for C and D, the cation and anion are roughly the same size, meaning that they're roughly the same distance from one another in the lattice. The difference, however, is that in compound C, the cation has a positive 2 charge and the anion has a negative 2 charge, versus in D, the cation has a positive 1 charge and the anion has a positive negative 1 charge. Which would you predict would be more attracted to each other, the ions in compound C or the ions in compound D? I would predict that the ions in compound C are more attracted to each other because they have a higher magnitude of charge. Think about this as compound C having two really strong magnets and compound D having two weak magnets interacting. In compound C, in the case of the strong magnet analogy, it would be very difficult to pull those things apart, those ions or those magnets apart, meaning that they are more attracted to each other than in the case of the weak magnet analogy or compound D. It turns out that this has a mathematical, this can be explained using a mathematical relationship called Coulomb's law, which was introduced in the chemical compounds module video about distinguishing compounds by bond type and compound type. Just to remind you, what this relationship tells us is that it describes the attractive force, in the case of an ionic compound, between a negatively charged and positively charged object as related to their charge and their distance between them. Mathematically, what happens as the distance between the ions gets larger? Well, this means that the denominator of this expression gets larger, and therefore, the attractive force described by the variable F decreases. Now, as the magnitude of the charge gets larger, the numerator gets larger, and as the numerator gets larger, the attractive force, or the variable F, increases. This is similar to our predictions that we made when looking at those two compound sets above us. A and B have the same magnitude of charge, but different distances. So this is similar to, or this explains our reasoning for that. Looking at compounds A and B, we see that A has less distance between it, causing the denominator to decrease, causing the attractive force to increase. What's happening in C and D is that in compound C, we have the magnitude of Q1 and Q2, the charges, increasing. Therefore, the numerator increases and the attractive force increases. Let's put this into practice. Which of these three compounds would you predict to be least soluble in water? Another way to think about this is, in which compound are the ions most attracted to each other, meaning that it would be most difficult for the attraction to be overcome when added to water. The key here is that our cations are represented by dark circles and our anions are represented by open circles. Here we're looking at sodium oxide, which you should know contains both sodium plus cations and O2 minus anions. Here we're looking at sodium chloride, Na plus cations, Cl minus anions. Here we're looking at aluminum oxide, which contains aluminum 3 plus cations and O2 minus anions. Now let's compare two at a time. Let's first compare sodium oxide and sodium chloride. These have the same cation, different anions, and those anions are both different sizes and charges. Let's first look at O2 minus versus Cl minus in terms of size. Which ion is larger based on the picture? You'll see that Cl minus is larger than O2 minus. So Cl minus is larger than O2 minus, which means that the based on just the size differences, that the ions in sodium chloride would be less attracted to each other than in sodium oxide. We can also look at the charges. So in the case of sodium oxide, we have a 2 minus charge versus chloride, we have a -1 charge. Remember, the greater the magnitude of charge, the stronger the attraction. So therefore, sodium oxide has a greater magnitude of attraction based on both the size and charge of the anions when compared to sodium chloride. So we can cancel sodium chloride off of our list. Next, let's compare sodium oxide and aluminum oxide. In this case, the cations are different, but the anions are the same. Remember, the anions are the open circles. You'll notice that the cations are very similar in size based on the picture. However, the charges are much different. In the case of sodium oxide, Sodium has a positive one charge. In the case of aluminum oxide, Al3 plus has a much greater charge. So in which lattice will the ions be more attracted to each other? I would say that aluminum oxide, the ions will be more attracted to each other based on the greater magnitude of charges within the lattice. Again, the anions are the same, so we can do this by comparing cation. Therefore, aluminum oxide should be the least soluble in water because the ions are most attracted to each other and therefore will be challenging to overcome those attractions when added to water. I hope that this video gave you some context behind the reasoning of a solubility table like this one shown here, and will allow you to predict ionic compound solubility based on ions, charge, and size. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll see you in the next one.